Hello, welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. This is, well, an interactive Let's Play where at the end of this video you get to choose the, well, among the choices presented, and that will be going, taking a vote and going forward into the next episode. So, we're here in this kitchen? Yeah. Opening a door crack, you see a riot of activity and heat. Goblins rush between fires and low tables, carrying heaps of food and pots of water. An enormous hobgoblin stands at the front of the room, shouting orders and waving a cleaver above his head. You'll need to get into the larder to find the secret passage. Yes, into... Mampeng. Go back further. That's Mampeng. Mampeng. So, majority rules, I believe it was unanimous that I stride in rather than creep in. You swing open the door, trying to look like you belong. No one pays you any attention. The large hobgoblin burps as he stirs the soup. Do we dare press this? Approach the hobgoblin. You stroll right up to the hobgoblin by the stove. And why not? But the whole place doesn't come crashing down on us. The head chef looks up to glare at you. You see the kitchen goblins pause, waiting with bated breath. Most have cleavers or knives of some kind, and you are quite considerably outnumbered. Great. No one crawls in here without my permission, the head chef declares from the stove. So tell me fast, why shouldn't I put you in the soup? Okay. I didn't crawl. I strode in. Thank you very much. The guards outside need food. The hobgoblin squints. And what did you think I was doing before you interrupted me? Cooking. You acknowledge. Exactly, he replies. He suddenly leans in, fingering his cleaver. But now you're here, you might as well help. You're a chef now, understand? He points with the cleaver across the room to where a gobliness... did not know a female goblin would be called a gobliness, is chopping furiously. Go see Filk, he says, picking up a head of lettuce. She'll get you started. With that, he turns away. Great. Now we gotta cook. I just want to get inside. Yeah, okay. If I just head to the larder room now, he might get pissed and attack. Or something. Let's approach Filk. You make your way around to the counter, the way the hobgoblin pointed out, is trying to lift a bag of potatoes that is almost her size. She collapses under the weight, but scrambles out from under the bag when she sees you. Yeah, it's quite attractive. She's gigantic for a goblin, but still a head shorter than you. Her apron is mostly stains, dirt, and a few threadbare ruffles. Yeah. I'm gonna pick up the sack. You pick up the sack and heft it back onto the worktop. The goblin scrambles to her feet. Filk, she announces, and you realize with a sickening feeling that she is vainly trying to tidy the thick mound of greasy hair on her head as she speaks. Greet her, yeah, I guess. No, better not. Do you need a hand? You ask, with the sack. She smiles weakly. And with everything else around here. She is visibly nervous. I'm to show you the kitchen and teach you the rules. What rules? She nods. First, never annoy the head chef. Second, don't drop anything. Like you. Third, don't go in the larder. The hobgoblin cook is very paranoid about that. He's convinced there are spies everywhere trying to steal his recipes. Frankly, I'm surprised he didn't skin you the moment you walked in. She blushes at some unknown thought. She's blushing. So I'd smile in return? Would that be flirting at that point? Spies? You ask with some interest. What's going on now? I just happened to glance at the bottom of the screen. Oh, I don't think they're real. Who would steal all Thunder Bowel's recipes? He doesn't even use spices. And they say there is someone sneaking into the fortress, but he's not here for the food, I'm sure. Filk looks at you sideways and then reaches out a tentative hand to touch yours. I guess I'll allow it. I might need her help. Maybe she can distract him. Okay, I'm gonna let her touch my hand. You stay still, and her cold, greasy goblin flesh settles on your arm. I'm so glad you're here, she says, suddenly talking to Rush. We need to get the soup made. Yes, we feed all the guards in the yard, so we're always busy. You chop these vegetables and get it simmering. I need to go grab some roach pig meat. Roach pig meat. She turns to go. I'll be right back. You can start the cooking, can't you? I will need instruction. She looks down at the floor. All right. I suppose you need to know what the hobgoblin wants, but you'll learn quick enough. Helps when your life depends on it. I'll be back in a moment. You get started on the vegetables. She hurries quickly away, tripping over something as she goes. Before you is a chopping board heaped with vegetables, onions, turnips, potatoes, and a few purple orbs you don't recognize. You will need a knife. Purple orbs. I don't suppose they're eyes of some beast. The knife rack. Yeah, so I'm pretty sure from what she said we should not try to go in the larder room at this point. You go over to the knife rack and pull out a blade. Two goblins across the kitchen are talking in low voices. Archmage? One remarks. It's a bit of wood the guards prop up against the tower window. The other goblin laughs. Test the knife blade. You test the edge. It is so dull you doubt it would cut butter. If it's a bit of wood, the second goblin whispers. How do you explain the birdmen? They're not natural. Sharpen the knife. There is a whetstone on the counter. You drag the knife blade back and forth a few times until it is keen. Go back to the counter. Then you head back over to the counter. Filk steals a quick glance and flashes a crooked smile. Oh no. She's hot for me. You examine the vegetables. Several are rotten. I'm told the birdmen are breeding. A third goblin hisses to the first two. I heard they have a nest. Throw out the rotten vegetables. You have a brief moment of wondering what on earth you were doing before you pick out the rotten vegetables and toss them away. A passing goblin looks over and remarks to another. Seems the new chef's got something to prove. There's no sign of Filk. Okay, they're still whispering. Don't be stupid. The first goblin whispering nearly hisses. Birdmen can't lay eggs. Think how big they'd be. We'd be using them to make our omelets, wouldn't we? All three snigger at the thought. Okay. So should I chop the vegetables coarsely or finely? Leave your votes in the comments below. No, just kidding. I don't know what it matters. Chop them finely. You smoothly and efficiently dice the vegetables with your sharp knife. Filk walks past, carrying a tray of overbaked breads. Stick them in the pot. They look excellent. She offers a quick, nervous smile, then is gone on another errand across the room. I really just want to get to the larder room. Maybe the head chef will leave at some point or get distracted. Maybe we can distract him. Next, you head over to the rack, where a random assortment of pots and pans hang from nasty-looking hooks. Most are dented or cracked, and some have holes rusted in the bottom. The group of goblins are still muttering. You should pop through the tunnel and find out. The third goblin says, Oh, except there's no tunnel in the larder, of course. That rumor is totally false. Indeed, huh? Take a new pot. Under a pile of lids without handles, you spot a gleaming new pot. You reach for it, but a goblin with an eye patch shoves in front of you. Hands off! He growls. Never mind, pick another pot. You shrug and turn back to the rack. If the birdmen are breeding, does that mean they might rebel? A fourth goblin asks from the nearby group nervously. The Archmage can't control creatures he doesn't make. Take the dented pot. You grab a serviceable pot. It's dented and old, but should hold its water. Take it. You heft up your pot and head over to the stove. Now, do these show up as items? Kind of wondering. No, it's just... I wouldn't think so. It's just very temporary items. I mean, but what if I just... See? If I just went to the larder now, I would not survive. If I went to the yard, I'd probably have trouble as well. So it's kind of a giveaway that the pot is not added to your inventory. Unless you drop the pot and head out to the yard kind of thing. Yeah, it could be. Alright, let's head to the stove. Returning back to the stove, you fill the pot with your finely chopped vegetables. You add the cleanest water you can find, which isn't very clean, and place it over the fire. The first whispering goblin shrugs. The Archmage is just a bit of wood in the window, he remarks. I think the Birdmen are in charge of this place anyway. Can I slip away? I'm kind of nervous to do that. Stir it. You stir carefully, allowing yourself to relax for a moment as you take in the aroma. It is an oddly calming moment. But then your reverie is broken by Philk returning and dumping roach pig meat into the mix. Hot water splashes up. She nods approvingly. Smells good, she says. We should add some flavor. The spices are over there. She hurries away once more. See, I'm waiting for a good opportunity, but... Spices? Alright. I don't see what... Sneaking away now would be any better than sneaking away in the beginning. So let's continue on and get spices. Wait for an opportunity, if hopefully there will be one. The spices are kept in boxes at the back of the room. All the herbs are from Zaman, and you don't recognize a single one. Read the labels. Three labels stand out. Ant powder, melted curios, and red-eye tears. Look at the ant powder. The label is half torn, but you're fairly sure it says ant powder. It's a fine dust. It doesn't smell like anything, and it tastes like almonds. Pick something else. You put it back on the rack. I can only take one thing. Look at the melted curios. Inside the jar is a solid lump of what looks like black wax. It smells like a sewer. From across the room, Philk waves. Not that one, she shouts. That one's for blackening the stove. Use it. Pick something else. You look for something else. Red-eye tears? Really? Inside the jar is a fizzling, bright red liquid. A drop on your tongue burns a little, but pleasantly. Let's take it. You grab your jar, hoping that what's inside is edible. Can't be too much worse than ant powder, right? You shake your jar back to Philk. She squints at the label, then smiles. That's such an interesting choice, she breathes. Interesting thing. I can either pour it into the pot myself or give it to her. I'll give it to her. You hand over the jar, and she empties it into the pot carelessly. The soup bubbles and churns. The goblins continue to whisper until the head chef walks past and smacks one over the head with a copper-based pot. All fall silent. I can spit in the soup. I don't know if I want to taste it either. Let's stir. You stir the broth. Excellent smells rise up from the surface. At Philk's insistence, the hobgoblin comes over to sniff the pot. Not bad, he grumbles. What's in it? Roach pig. The goblin nods. Good. I'm glad someone around here cares about the cooking. No one here appreciates good ingredients like me. I am Throg, the most careful chef in Mampang. Throg takes a spoon and sips carefully. Then he beams with pleasure. Delightful, he roars. Gather round, you lumps. He gives you a clap on the shoulder that is only a little less painful than his blows of anger. This is a chef. She's going to go places, you hear? Let's not get too full of ourselves. Let's just wave. You try to look suitably humble. Someone take this to the mess hall, Throg shrieks. And you get access to the good ingredients, he winks. Go check the larder. It's full of real meat. Go to the larder. Try not to think about what he means by real meat. You head towards the larder. Yes, this is what we were waiting for. I'm afraid I'm not coming back out of the larder. I hope I find my little secret passage quickly. You open the door and slip into the larder. It is stocked with food that looks actually edible, unlike most of what is piled in the kitchen. But there doesn't seem to be much more to it, except that you were told that somewhere in here is a secret passage into the heart of the fortress. Yes, I'm well aware of that. The door opens behind you, and Filk slips in, somewhat breathlessly. I thought I could help, she blushes. So we've got a lesbian goblin. Goblin-ess. Huh. This affair has gone far enough. Is that what this is? An affair? I thought I could help. I heard there was a tunnel in here. I don't want to... Yeah. I don't want to end it here. And I don't want to end it. I don't want to say that. That's rude. I heard there was a tunnel in here, so I'll just get right to it. She stops and stares at you. A tunnel? She demands. Into the fortress? Is it true? I've never heard of a tunnel, she replies. But if it was true, why aren't people coming through? Perhaps no one knows. She shivers. They're like rats in there. Rats always know when there are tunnels. You turn, ignoring the gobliness. Oh my, we have choices. Once more, but she seems content. She comes to stand beside you. So, she says, what shall we do next? Oh, now I need to get rid of her. Inspect the floor. You bend down to squint at the floor. Some flower dust has been spilled here. So where do you think it is? Filk asks. The tunnel? Flower pattern. The spilled flowers indeed picked up a strange pattern on the floor, as if someone had tried to scuff away footprints near one particular floorboard. What is it? Filk demands. Have you seen something? I'm tempted. I really want to take some rations. I got 6 rations. You quickly gather a good number of loaves of bread and blocks of cheese, along with a few more obscure items. This should hopefully keep you stocked for the rest of your journey. Filk watches you nervously. You better hope Throg doesn't catch you doing that, she hisses. Give some food to Filk. You offer some food from the shelf to Filk, but she pushes it away. Clear panic in her eyes. I couldn't, she hisses. What if someone walked in? Let me just look around a little bit. You search around the shelves and come across an interesting old cloth bag that rattles when you pick it up. Look inside. You open the string on the bag and tip out the contents. 3 oversized teeth tumble out into your palm. Giant's teeth, Filk remarks. If you boil them for, about a week, they make quite a powerful stock. Good for special occasions. Do I dare? Keep them? You nod and slip the teeth into your money pouch. Search around the sacks. You move some sacks to get better access to the far wall, but it is solid stone. What should I get from here? You ask Filk. She looks at you, eyes wide. What would you like? She replies. Get some ingredients? You browse the shelves for ingredients and catch yourself. You are not here to become a chef. All right, let me look at the spot. Inspecting carefully, you notice a thin seam running across some floorboards. A less clever observer would never have noticed it. You pick up a nearby fork and pry at the seam. A section of the floor pops up on disguised hinges. A trap door! Phil gasps. I forgot the quotes. I just want to see what rations we have. Da-da. 4 meals. It just says 4 meals. That's cool. Look down the trapdoor. You peer down into the darkness below the kitchen. A chill breeze is rushing along the tunnel. It must go for some distance. What is it? Filk breathes. A tunnel? Inside? Do you want to come? Inside? They're all mad inside the walls. She shivers. I won't even be able to sleep again knowing that's here. Philk is tense as you peer down into the hole. You could turn back or descend below. They're all mad inside the walls? Who? The rats? Alright, let's go. Coming or not, here I go. You climb downwards into the tunnel, squinting in the dim light. It's narrow, but there doesn't seem to be anyone in it. Are you really going? Philk whispers from above. Come with me. She seems to consider your offer for a moment and then shakes her head. But I can't come with you. Look at that tunnel. I won't fit. Isn't there another way? Lying. I'll come back for you. You promise. But she shakes her head, not believing. Goodbye, she whispers in reply. I hope you find whatever it is you're looking for. Ah, she's so sweet. With that, she closes the trapdoor over your head. Oh, would you close the trapdoor for me? Nice! You hear the scrape as a flower bag is shifted on top of it, and a distant wail of tears. There's no turning back now. Ah! Ah, she's like nasty looking, but she's really sweet, and she's crying, and she closed the trap door and put the flower bag on top. This is like one of the nicest people we've met on our journey. Holy crap. I feel bad. Especially I lied to her. Alright, let's go down. You slither and slide your way down into the darkness of the tunnel. It is unclear who built this. There are no supports or indications of construction. There seem to be tooth marks in the walls. Tooth marks? Scramble onwards. You splash on through the shallow water. The rock walls drip with dank moss, and the smell is stale and fetid. There is no way to tell how much more of this there is to go. Oh yeah, there is. Because I got to scramble onwards, and we'll come up here. Okay, I just heard something growling. Scrambling onwards, then. You splash onwards. The tunnel turns a corner here, rising upwards toward a chink of light. Around the corner, yeah, something's there. You climb upwards, using the rough edge of the tunnel as footholds to ascend. There's a fresh scent from somewhere overhead. Keep climbing. After some more clambering, you come within sight of a grate in the ceiling. Light filters through, and standing right on top of it are a pair of feet. Look up at the grate. The grate looks fixed into the stone. It is not hinged or designed to be opened, presumably just to let this tunnel vent steam. Listen. You wait a few seconds and are rewarded as the guards above begin to chatter. Keep your eyes open, a gruff voice murmurs. They say she's on her way. Who? You know who. I'm not worried, the second guard replies. No assassin can kill the Archmage. However clever they are. Press on? What, push the thing? Let's cast a spell. Cause drowsiness or sleep or something. Be good. Talk with animals. Well, those are guards. I don't think they're animals. Summon a giant. Okay, that would be in the tunnel with me, though, I think. Unless I can aim it above? That'll cause quite a ruckus. I'd rather slip in, but I don't know if I can. Aim. Open locks and doors. Well, the guy's standing on it. Cause clumsiness. Ooh, that's a good choice. I'm leaning towards that so far. Illusion of treasure. That looked at that, right? Yeah. Okay, so dumb so far. Create glue. Can that do? Cause fear. Not here. Sorry, guys. Gak is cross fear. Okay. A-U. Wasn't there another? Oh god. Oh, right. Okay, then we've also got... Okay, that's lightning zap. Yeah, we've only got that. We got a lot of choices with this one. Hover in the air. It's not gonna help. Unknown. Heh. I'd rather not then. Create illusions. It's a good choice too. Clumsiness. Unfortunately it causes stamina loss, but what are you gonna do? You cast the enchantment. From above you, you see sudden movement. A guard's foot staggering to one side. There's a clatter of armor, and a second guard curses and shouts with annoyance. A moment later, a full-on brawl is occurring, and a messy one in that. A few minutes later, the two guards have chased each other away, hurling insults this way and that. That's funny. So, what I would like to do... We have so many rations, right? Actually... Rations. That wasn't much. It gets good enough. Alright, listen. You listen closely for a few seconds, but hear nothing. More light filters down from above, now that the guards above have gone. You push on through the tunnel further underneath Mempeng. Oh, am I supposed to go into the grate, or is this something else? You reach the end of the tunnel. A short flight of slick stone steps leads up to a trapdoor in the ceiling. Oh. I thought we were coming up here. I thought that was the end. All right. The trapdoor is set neatly into the rocky ceiling and is closed tight. It looks as though it hasn't been opened in a very long time. Let's try it. You scramble quickly upwards, keen to get out of the tunnel as quickly as possible. But the trapdoor, when you reach it, is so firmly locked it does not even shiver when you shove at it. Don't bang it. Use a knock spell. It would open doors and locks, whatever they call it. Which is what again? Starts with D? Yeah. Looking to the constellations overhead, you craft a spell, but nothing happens. The trapdoor does not even shake. Perhaps it is protected by some magical defense, or else it is not a door at all. Bang on it? I don't know. You bang on the trapdoor. It doesn't budge, not even slightly. More suspiciously, it barely even booms. Pull at the wood. You pull at the wood of the trapdoor, and after some work with a chopping knife, a strip falls away, revealing smooth rock beneath. It seems this once was a trapdoor, but it has since been filled in, perhaps with a petrification spell cast onto the wood itself. There is no way up from the tunnel, it seems. You turn back, hopelessly, toward the thin light from the grate. All right. Hope these guards didn't come back. You return along the tunnel when you hear something growling. It seems your banging has attracted attention. Listen. You stop to listen. The sound is all too familiar. It is the yawning growl of a rat bear. The sound is getting closer. Run? Where? For the trapdoor? Nope. You turn to run, but the creature is far faster than you. It races through the shallow water and strikes you down. Why has it already hit me? You roll, drawing your sword. There was no choice but to fight. 8 stamina for this thing. Let's go with the heavy cut. Oh, that's not good. The Ratbear advances at speed, splashing through filthy water on all fours with its vicious tail poised to spike. But you will not be intimidated by a rodent, however big. You plant your feet and ready a mighty sword swing. At the last moment, the Ratbear leaps, all claws off the ground and ready to plunge into your body. It takes you by surprise and wide open. If you die down here, your body will wash up in the river in a few more days. Well, it won't matter if I'm dead, where it washes up, or where it ends up, right? Now, I know we can't rewind. Can I do battles over? That's a good question. Otherwise, can I load a save file? I hope we don't have, like, this permadeath thing. That would suck. Alright, I'm gonna cut. Got him. Nice. You risk an attack. Rushing forward, you charge at the rat bear. Just as it comes for you, you cut its attack down. You have opened a deep wound inside. It drops to all fours and lowers its head. What's it gonna do? Ram me? Let's defend. That was not bad. Warily, you move into a defensive crouch. The rat bear stays low and tries to ram you. Exactly. For a moment, it is close enough for you to smell its sewer breath. Yummy! It scurries away from you, splashing across the room. Gotcha! You risk an attack. Standing firm against the wall, you swing a mighty blow at the rat bear, catching it a light blow. The rat bear is bleeding into the water below. Don't drink the water! Do I dare just sideswipe? Yeah, it was a bit. Ouchies! The rat bear whips out with its vicious tail. Your own attack is forgotten as you try to regain your balance. You find yourself gasping for breath. The foul stench coming off the beast is the stench of the grave. I'm going to defend this time. And we will attack strong. Now. Warily, you move into a defensive crouch. The rat bear rushes you. At the last moment, you splash aside. You murmur a hopeful prayer. It splashes away from you into the far gloom. You risk an attack. It always starts with that. Dropping your weight, you chop a mighty stroke against the rat bear, slipping a light blow past its claws. The rat bear screeches in an inhuman howl, and you take heart. It has almost fallen. Risk a sideswipe. Ah! Oh, dead. Good. I can try again. The rat bear lashes out with its savage claws. You stagger and fall into the filth. The rat bear dives after you, pushing you under. You drown and die of your wounds all at once. What a way to go. Okay. Starting out. Defend. Wow. That was a good choice. The rat bear advances at speed, splashing through filthy water on all fours with its vicious tail poised to strike. You drop quickly backwards through the water and raise your sword, ready to defend yourself. At the last moment, the rat bear leaps, all claws off the ground and ready to plunge into your body. You brace yourself as it comes down. For a moment, it is close enough for you to smell its sewer breath. Yeah, some of that red. Alright, we will do a heavy cut. Good. You have opened a deep wound in its side. Okay, it's going to do its charge thing. We're going to defend. Oh, that wasn't a bad charge at all. What? Splashing across the room. Cut. Bleeding into the water. Good. Defend. You can almost smell the creature growing enraged and duck quickly back through the water. The rat bear's tail whips through the water, sending up showers of spray, but you leap aside to safety. You swing your arm and refresh your stance. It splashes away from you into the far gloom. Goodbye. You risk an attack. Dropping your weight, you chop a mighty stroke against the rat bear. Then your sword finds its way down into the creature. The heavy beast screams, and the echo of the noise shakes the stones and disappears off down a tunnel. But the rat bear is dead. 3 stamina lost. Decent dueling. So I might have caught more attention from all this. You stop to recover your breath, but though you are alive, you are still stuck down in the dark. I'm going to take one more ration, just in case. Since we have them. A meal. Ugh. One, okay. One hit point back, fine. Let's, do something. Throw something. You find a chunk of stone and toss it up against the grate. Nothing else happens. Alright, casting a spell. Knock spell again? I'm assuming this is going to be all the same spells. Wait, this is new. Create illusions? Oh, no, not new. One stamina. That's not bad. You turn the starlight into alignment around you, and the grate overhead flips open. Climbing up. You jump to try and grab the overhead grate, but you cannot reach it. Oh, seriously? We need another spell. I don't think giant form would work. We'd, get crushed in here. Maybe hover. Which is... Zen? You weave the spell and a medallion begins to glow as you rise gently up into the air. Float through the grate. You float out... You float up and out through the open grate. Yay, finally. Out of the tunnel. You settle into the dirt of Bampang and kick the grate shut behind you. You are in a narrow alley between two large buildings. At the far end, you can see a glimpse of some kind of plaza. Night has fallen. You need to rest. You slip your way forwards. I need to rest, but I'm not going to rest yet. Alright. Along the alley. There is barely enough space to walk between the two buildings, which list inwards on both sides. Look at them. The buildings on both sides are topped by large glass domes. The one on the right larger than that of the left. You sidle onwards down the alleyway. The alley widens out a little here as it approaches a square at the end. You are inside the city. Sorry about that. It's my phone. Time to explore. Looking around, you are surprised to find that this part of Mampang is more like a city than you expected. There are merchants, laborers, and swaggering guards. Washing hangs from hooks outside the stacked houses. Of course, there are far more wicked glares and knives tucked into belts than even in Kare. Suddenly, you feel hooked fingers catch your arm. One of the birdmen? Turn around. You turn around and catch a glimpse of a hoary old beggar pulling at you. But then something happens and you lose sight of him. Huh. A moment later, the tall buildings of Mampang that you traveled so far to reach have disappeared. What? What's going on? We're floating up... What? You stand in a humid climate. Where the hell are we? I'm back in Kare? What the fraggin'? Dot dot dot. Oh, I hear another growling thing. Tall plants lean down on all sides, and a thin, watery sunlight leaks through some kind of glass ceiling, choked with weeds. Where am I? You look around, startled. The beggar is still here, but no longer holding your arm. He stands taller and seems better fed. That's better, he declares. Now we can talk more freely. Who are you? My name is Throben. Oh. I've heard of him, yeah. The beggar bows most politely. You notice he wears a circlet of finger bones on his head. Some have called me necromancer, but they only mean that death has never stopped my work. You are dead? Sometimes. Not entirely. Though I rather think I soon will be. Well, he adds, spreading his hands, soon can be confusing, of course. Perhaps we should start from the beginning. Where are we? This is a favorite little spot of mine, a forgotten corner of Kari, the lost gardens of Briar. Even the gardeners who work here can't remember the way in. It's on all the maps, but no one can find the entrance. My own little fortress. He reaches rather tenderly for a nearby plant, and pulls off a graying leaf. Throben smiles. Come, let's walk a little, shall we? He begins to saunter between its trees, and you follow. What have you done? Moved us elsewhere, Throben replies, so we can talk. This place is hidden from the Archmage. You observe. Quite so, Throben replies. The Archmage would chew a death sponge mushroom and then eat my brains if he had a chance. Best for all of us that if that doesn't happen. Throben points at a nearby flower. Do you see this one? Purple thornweed. Only grows in one place. The slopes above my home village. Where is that? I grew up in the same village as the Archmage, you know. A small place called Kariyama. Maybe you've heard of it. Yeah, it sounds familiar. He sweeps away, his face hidden from view. This way now. He steps between two plants and disappears. Kariyama. Isn't that from the first game? Okay. I hear like a lion or something and a cat. Into the gardens. Oh, I've been running for quite a while. You push your way between the plants and find the beggar waiting, only now he is no beggar, but a tall, handsome man, wearing a long cloak embroidered with runes of power. There you are, he booms. I was told to expect you. Where is the old man? Safely in my future, he replies with a smile. Okay, he's time-traveling, or we're time-traveling, or I'm not even sure. Please excuse any confusion. I use these gardens for conversations quite extensively, but I have to space them out. One cannot have things overlapping. Now then, he smiles, I believe we are, will be, talking about Mampang and your impending death. I am not going to die. You most certainly are, he replies. Often, I shouldn't wonder. Die often? He points up. The dome is gone, and it is now night time. Stars shine overhead. I like these gardens for one reason above all. Can you see what it is? The constellations. Exactly. He sighs with evident pleasure. Look up there, he declares, pointing. This is one of only two places in Kari where the stars of the Zed spell can be seen. Right, the mystery spell. The other is by the north gate, but that spot's rather too busy. What do you know of that spell? The mention of Zed makes you stop short. The secret magic. The most powerful knowledge unknown to all. What do you know of that spell, you demand? Zed, he intones, is the great discovery of the necromancers. A spell powered by and fascinated by death. Some thought it prevented death, but it does not. Quite the opposite. The stars of Zed cause a death of the most significant, final kind. What is it for? The man nods. It is a spell of such power and significance, its secret must never be divulged. I have told you enough in this place. Please. God damn it, tell me. He gestures at another path, leading between trees as wide as bears, that have fallen together to form an arch. After you. Through the arch. Are we gonna fight something here? You slip under the arch and arrive in a field of bright yellow and purple flowers, terrifically overgrown. Brambles choke the edges of the path. The man does not follow. You call out, but hear no response. It seems you are quite alone. High above, you see two harpies flying past, screaming to each other and pointing, but they are not coming for you. Search the bushes? You search the bushes but find nothing. There is nothing hiding here, nothing waiting for you. The beggar has abandoned you. It seems you must find the path back to Mampang yourself. Alright, let's go onwards. You push forwards through the towering flowers into an area of cracked blue paving and fronded shrubs in glass pots. To your relief, the beggar is here once more. He looks older than ever. Now you understand, he hisses. Now you see why you have to die. I do not understand you.
I'll tell you all you need to know, he says. The Zed spell is difficult to cast, you see, because you can't cast it at once. You have to cast it two separate times. Two times, but one casting. Got it? Like left and right hands clasped together.
He demonstrates, linking thumbs and flapping his fingers like a butterfly.
Cast it two separate times. Two times, but one casting.
Huh. All right.
You begin now and finish later? No, he says, wincing slightly as he speaks. I mean, when both castings are cast, they are the same casting. Two castings at different times cannot be at different times, so the time between disappears.
He squashes his butterfly fingers into a single two-handed fist.
So this is a spell for traveling in time? That's like saying a card is a machine for pushing the world backwards.
The beggar spits a tooth, then picks it up to admire.
Be valuable, that. One of these days, he remarks.
Is he giving it to me? Take the tooth?
You reach down for it. Uncouth villain, he curses, batting your hand away. Now you best be getting on.
Uncouth villain.
We don't want you coming back here when you finally die.
When I die?
Yes.
Throben closes his dirt-smudged eyes and concentrates, and slowly the walls of Mampang return.
Okay, I do not understand.
There you are again, smiles the beggar, who is now back as he began. He lifts a crooked finger.
Not a word. There are spies everywhere.
One last thing to do. Draw your sword.
Why?
You ask suspiciously. It's the sort of thing people do in Mampang.
Draw it.
Okay, I'll draw it. You obediently draw your blade. Throben beams with glee, and then before you can stop him, he runs himself deep onto the blade.
Yes.
For the ghost of the Backlands, I curse you with this, he whispers, and there's fury in his eyes. In the last moments, you see him hurl up his arms, creating some kind of incantation. A terrible force builds around his body, but then seems to only half explode. You are caught at the moment of detonation.
What?
I'm caught in a detonation? I gain stamina. The explosion dies away, its force curiously unspent, as though waiting, but you feel stronger for it.
Okay.
Interesting. What now? I can't go anywhere. You look around, still disoriented. Shouldn't be disoriented? There was no sign of the beggar. The narrow alley mouth opens into the square. The stars turn in the sky overhead.
We're almost full stamina. I'm just going to make a move.
You know, maybe I will sleep here. All right. The alley isn't a bad place to rest. It is quiet, secluded, and offers plenty of shadow. Laying your pack down, you try to settle despite the cold. I already ate something today. You lie back and try to forget your troubles. We're full. It's been a while since we've been full stamina. The long night is kept busy with visions. Mocking laughter seems to ring in your ears. Alley between buildings. During the past day, you gained one provision and some gold, plus 5. Visited the barracks, disguised yourself as a guard, and were cursed with the Zed spell. The Archmage is still looking for you. You get quickly to your feet. You have not been discovered, but you should not wait any longer. The Zed spell. Does it say what it is now? I think it's a... In all recorded history, this spell has been cast only once by a powerful necromancer from Throben, who was never seen again. His name is Throben. Necromancer's notes were found, but were crazed and unclear. Treat with extreme caution. Any clues or anything? Alright. Throben. Third spell. The Throben Doors. Into the square. You emerge from the alley into the edge of the main square. Alright, let's explore then. Into the square. I'm not trying to rewind, don't worry, game. A few clouds scud across the sky. You stride out into the middle of the public square where Manpeng's inhabitants go about their business. In the center is a huge statue of a faceless man holding the crown aloft, the Archmage. The statue seems unimaginably old, and yet the Archmage depicted here is definitely holding the crown of kings. Has he been planning this step for such a long time, then? Or is this prophecy a celebration of a day destined to come? Many people here are simply passing through, but several are browsing the market on the west side. You also spot several guards to the north clustered around a road that leads upwards. You could head in several directions from here. Wow. All right. Let's go this archway, then. I definitely want to look around this place. You march through the arch into a well-appointed empty courtyard. From a small booth by the entranceway, a guard nods to you. Soldier? Cool. You step into the central courtyard that fills this enclosure. The place is blessedly quiet, with several routes leading out of it. A dome looks up at the sky, and you spot the occasional birdman flying overhead. A fountain plays in the center of the courtyard. Look at the fountain. I don't need to eat food. The water from the fountain plays merrily over several stone statues set into the center of the bowl, arching satyrs, weeping maidens, aged men, head-butting orcs. It must tell some legend, but what that legend might be has clearly been lost to time and the wearing water. A few brightly feathered birds flap past overhead. This little square is almost comfortable. Okay, I'm not going to drink or eat food because that would give us hit points, I think, and we're full. Search the courtyard. You look around the courtyard, but there isn't much to see beyond the fountain and the benches that surround it. The doors are a mixture of shops and storage rooms. A door leads out to the main square of the inner city, but there are several other doors leading off from the courtyard. One is signposted Nylock. Nylock. Oh, wow. Let's check the side chamber. Still, guys, I know we've been running for a while, but... Oh, Nylock shop was a shop. I'm waiting for a choice to happen. You slip into a small side room. Inside are a pile of crates in a side room that are marked with the seal of Kare. There are several stacked crates, each bearing the official mark of Kare's first noble. What are they doing here? A few large empty crates lie undisturbed at the back of the room. Open an empty crate? Should I? You open one of the large crates, empty and roomy. It occurs to you that you could hide your guard's uniform in one of the boxes for use later. Why would I do that? It's a good disguise. Open a sealed crate. The crates are nailed shut, but you manage to slip your longsword between two boards. You pry off the lid. Inside are stacks of magical armor, the kind you saw used in Kare by Vic's army of werewolves. How could they possibly be here? And if it's here, is Vic here too? Look at the armor. You see several sets of lupine armor up close during your time in Kare. This looks similar, though perhaps not as well made. Well, we'll keep this in mind if we find some place that we run into werewolves. We'll come back here and stash our disguise and get that armor, I'm guessing. Provided it'll fit us, so let's leave. You leave the crates behind and return to the courtyard. You step out into the courtyard once more. For once the sun is shining in Manpeng. It is refreshing to feel the warmth on your face. Which way now? Why this way? The guard room. You approach the guard's room. The guard turns to you with a narrowed, unfriendly eyes. What? What are you guarding? The vaults of Manpeng, she replies. But don't tell anyone. With that, she waves you away. You head back to the courtyard. We got clues. A clue. Manpeng hides a vault. There's a secret vault somewhere under the merchant's building in Manpeng. Cool. You step out into the courtyard once more. This courtyard wasn't designed as a pleasure garden. There are no plants or decoration, but it's deserted, and that is pleasurable enough. Which way now? Let's go to this side chamber. You choose a small side door which opens to reveal dirty living quarters. A bare rug covers the floor and an unmade bed lists in the corner. A wood chest sits at its foot facing an empty table. This is presumably home to some lowly guard or other. What is that? That's a face there. Oh, they're masks? Got a mask here. Examine the bed. You go over to the bed and rifle through the ratty covers to discover nothing but a stained mattress. Hay pokes out of one side. It doesn't look like anyone has slept in it for a while. Look under the bed. You peer underneath the bed with your weapon drawn, but all you find is an old shirt. Lie down, no. Dig in the hay. You dig around in the hay and discover the last rat to attempt the same thing, but nothing more. Leave it alone. You turn away from the bed. Pull up the rug. I'll check the chest last. You grab the edge of the rug, long sword at the ready. Flip it over. You flip it aside to find a small trap door set into the floor of the room. I'm going to leave it alone for now. You let the rug fall once more. Open the chest. You squat down in front of the chest. There is no lock. You scrutinize the chest, running your finger along the latch. It appears safe. You flip open the lid. Nothing. The box is empty. There isn't even a cobweb or a loose gold coin. Maybe this is a simple servant's room. You lift the box out from under the table and turn it over. Then you hear a click from somewhere behind you. Look around. You turn and rush toward the exit, but you are too late. A heavy portcullis has dropped from the ceiling, barring the doorway. You are trapped. From somewhere nearby, you hear a hissing noise. Look around. You look around the floor of the room, expecting to see a snake. Nothing moves. Look up. You look open to see a greenish cloud descend from the ceiling. Poison gas! This is not anyone's living quarters. This room is nothing but a trap, and you have walked straight into it. Okay, guys. Without even looking at the spells, what do you think we should do? Should I try to break open the portcullis, hold my breath, or cast a spell? I could look at the spells, but I'm going to leave it like this. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Thanks for voting. And, yeah, don't forget to vote on one of these three options. And, yeah, that's pretty much it. Thanks so much for watching, guys. And endure, and enduring, grow strong. See you next week.